In this video, I'm going to show you how to create your own custom classes within Kotlin, as well as how Kotlin constructors work, covering both primary constructors and what we call secondary constructors. Kotlin does approach the concept of classes and constructors a bit differently from some other object-oriented programming languages. So without further ado, let's get into it. So to kick things off, the first thing that I want to do is let's create a new class. So in Kotlin, similar to Java, you can create a new class representing the file name that the class is going to be named. We'll right click new Kotlin class or file. We'll call it my class. First big thing you might notice is right next to the class keyword, there's no public, private, protected, anything like that. And in Java, that's referred to as the access modifier. In Kotlin, that is the visibility modifier. The default visibility modifier is public, which is different from the package private default modifier that Java has, which is a bit of an adjustment for the Java programmers out there. So I could just add it here, but it really doesn't gain me anything because it's a default modifier. So I'm just gonna go ahead and remove that. And the next thing that's interesting about classes in Kotlin is that the class body, so what is between these curly braces here, this is optional. This code, while strange, is perfectly legal and basically just indicates that I have a class with no body in it. So what's the use in that, huh? Well, let's go ahead and find out. So I'm going to make a val called my class, and I'm going to set it equal to my class. Pretty cool. With little code, we already have our own class created. Yes. So let's go ahead and add some more things into our class. Let's give our class a body, and now let's give our class a property. We'll just call it prop1, and we'll say that it's a string, and it's equal to property1. And because I'm initializing this into a string, I don't even need to declare the type because of type inferencing. So now that I've declared prop1 in here, and remember that the default visibility modifier is public, I can use the dot notation and I can access prop1. So like public fields in Java, a property can be accessed outside of the class when it is declared in such a way that the visibility modifier allows for that. So public in this case would allow that. All right, so now back to my class. Let's say that I get rid of the body again. And now I want to declare a constructor for my class. So to do that, I can use the constructor keyword. And let's say that I want to pass in a value into my constructor. We're just going to call it value, and we're going to say that it's a string. A few things to note here. Value is the name of the variable, and I'm declaring that it's a string. And this constructor keyword indicates that I'm about to declare a constructor. This right here, which comes right after the class declaration, is what's called the primary constructor. Kotlin classes have a primary constructor, and a primary constructor is always what is executed first when a class gets instantiated. And one other thing to note is that just like Java, you can add different visibility modifiers for the constructors. So for instance, if you didn't want somebody outside of the class to instantiate it, you could mark it private. But the default visibility modifier is public. And when you have a public constructor, the constructor keyword is not necessary either. So now your code simplifies to this. If I go back to my main, I now have an error because I have to pass in a parameter to my constructor here. So let's go ahead and put in a string of my value, which is hello. And now the code compiles again. But all I'm doing is creating this my class object, and I'm not doing anything with it. I'm just passing in this value. Let's go ahead and print out the value. Now we're gonna add what's called an initializer block or init block. The init block is run once the primary constructor is done. And the syntax is just init like this. So let's say I wanna print out value, and then I'm gonna use string templates here to print the value like that. All right. Now, if I run this code without actually using the my class value at all, we're going to see that we're going to enter the primary constructor and set the value equal to the passed in value, and then we're going to print it out right here. And the value is equal to hello. Awesome. So just to kind of walk through what that did again, the primary constructor starts right here, And then you have this first init block, which runs right after the primary constructor. So you can have as many init blocks as you want. Let's say that I want to do value second time. And then I print the value again. And the order of the init blocks is going to follow the order in which they are declared within the Kotlin class. In addition, when I am using these init blocks, I also have initializers for my properties. So let's make a property here called property one. And then we're gonna set it to a value of yo. And just to prove that this initializer does get called in between the two init blocks, I'm going to call also, and then I'm going to have it run print line. And there we have it. So the first init block gets executed. Then we have this property initializer that gets executed. And then we have the second init block, which gets executed. Cool, right? So that is the general idea of how a Kotlin class gets constructed and how it gets initialized. Now, there are some more details I want to go over, such as shorthand of how you can declare a property within the constructor. So that's actually really convenient. Let's say, for example, that I wanted to access value here outside of the Kotlin class. I can't do that. So I can do my class.value, and Kotlin doesn't know what this value property is because it's not a property. It's just a parameter passed into the constructor. So to fix that, if I declare value as a val or as a var, then what'll happen is this is now converted into a property that is persisted beyond the primary constructor. Isn't that pretty cool? And we'll see, just as an example, my class.value now shows up in our list. So to state that one more time, when I pass in a value into my constructor here, if I don't declare it as a var or a val, it is interpreted as a local within the constructor and it doesn't persist as a property or anything like that. But if I want this to directly translate into a property, then all I need to do is mark it as either a var if you can write to it, or a val if it is read-only. I'm gonna go ahead and change this to my val just to make it a little clearer, and I'm gonna remove some of these other init blocks. We'll call this my val. Now, another really cool thing about Kotlin is when you make a function, functions can take default values, and that applies to constructors as well. So let's say that I want my val to have a default value of an empty string. Now, when I construct my object, I don't have to pass in anything right there, and the code still compiles. And we can see that if I want to print my class.myVal, I get nothing currently, and then I get a blank new line here, which isn't very convincing, actually. So I'm gonna change this to todo and rerun it quick. Okay, much better. So this shows an example of calling it from the initializer block, as well as getting the public property and getting the value of it within the main function. So just like classes, I do have visibility modifiers that I can add onto properties. For example, something like this. And now that I have my val marked as private, if I were to go back to my main function, we can see that I can't access it anymore. Kotlin has four different visibility modifiers: public, private protected, and internal. Each of those means slightly different things depending on the context of whether you're talking about a package, a class, a property, etc. But the big thing to remember is that the default visibility modifier is public. And then next we have what are called secondary constructors. So a secondary constructor is something that must always call the primary constructor. And I'm going to use this same constructor keyword again. And what I have to do is I have to explicitly call the primary constructor, which you might be familiar with if you've done constructor overloading in a language like Java, where you use the this keyword and then you give the parameters that in this case the primary constructor is looking for. So I'm going to say from secondary. And I don't need to have any body within this constructor, but if I wanted to, I could. So let's think about this here for a second. So my primary constructor has a single parameter with a default value, And my secondary constructor takes no parameters and then fills in the default value for the primary constructor. So when I'm calling the constructor like this, do you think it's going to call todo or from secondary? And interestingly, it calls from secondary. So this is an important point to think about. When you have a constructor whose signatures could look equivalent when you take into account default arguments, in this case, the secondary constructor takes precedent. So a bit of an interesting thing to think about when you're thinking about different constructor parameter lists. That's why when you make a secondary constructor, I highly recommend that you make the parameters very explicit. So for example, let's pass in an int here. So we'll just call it my int, and we'll say that it's the int type. And then now I want to add a body into my secondary constructor, and that is going to be to print my int. All right. And then now I'm going to put in a value of 1 here. And let's go ahead and see what this prints. Ah, here's where it gets interesting as well. Note that here we start by calling the secondary constructor, but we're calling the primary constructor here first, which then goes through the process of calling the init block. So then we set up my val here. Hence my val from secondary. And then we execute the block of the secondary constructor, which is where we get this. And then when that's done, then we return my class back, and then we print out the value that was set up right here. So to summarize what this log is saying right here, the secondary constructor always gets executed second or later. And what I mean by that is the secondary constructor's body gets executed after the primary constructor and after all of the property initializers and the init blocks that come with the primary constructor. One other note I want to make on secondary constructors is that they are a language feature and you can use them, but most of the Kotlin programmers I know don't use them with much regularity. They try to put everything they can into a primary constructor or into those init blocks. Or sometimes you might need something like a top level function or something like that. But every once in a while, you might need a secondary constructor, and they do have their purpose, but I would avoid doing secondary constructors unless you think you really need them. For instance, a lot of folks think they might need a secondary constructor for all the default values they might give to myVal or something like that, but you don't really need that because you can just use the default parameter values that Kotlin provides. So the typical way of constructor overloading is more or less unnecessary in Kotlin. Where it really comes down is if you need to translate different data types over. So let's say I pass in an integer, which is the age of someone, versus I pass in a person object and the person has an age associated with it. I might have a secondary constructor for a person object, and then the primary constructor would be called with the person's age. That would be an example I could see with using a secondary constructor. But most of the time in other languages where you would have a long list of constructors doing constructor overloading, in Kotlin you won't do that nearly as much. And that was an overview of creating your own classes within Kotlin and a little bit about constructors and initializer blocks, secondary constructors, and property initializers, as well as quickly touching on the visibility modifiers within Kotlin. I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, please do smash that like button. I'd really appreciate it. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.